Today we are having Her Grace Preeti Vilasini Mataji to enlighten us on Chaitanya Charitamrita. So thank you so much, Mataji, for your nectarian classes. Always the classes are so nectarian. So Mataji, now I would like to hand over the call to you. Thank you so much, Mataji. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Dandavat pranams to everyone on the call. Thank you so much, Pavitra Madhavi Mataji, for the chanting and the wonderful services. So, we'll continue to read from Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita, Madhya Leela, Chapter 19. And today we will be doing verse 52 onwards. Chaitanya Charitamrita, Madhya Leela, 19.152. Malihana karesi bija aropana shavana kitana jale koraya sichana. Translation. When a person receives the seed of devotional service, he should take care of it by becoming a gardener and sowing the seed in his heart. If he waters the seed gradually by the process of shavana kitana, hearing and chanting, the seed will begin to sprout. ॐ अज्ञानति निरान्धस्य ज्ञानाञ्जनाशलाकाय चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः. श्रीचैतन्यमनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूपा कदा मह्यं ददाति स्वापदान्तिकम्. वन्देहं श्रीगुरुः श्रीयुतापदकमलं श्रीगुरुं वैष्णवांश्च श्रीरूपं साग्रजातं सहगणरघुनाथान्वितं तं सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजनसहितं श्रीकृष्णचैतन्यदेवम् Shri Radha, Krishna Padan, Sahagana Lalita, Sri Vishakhanditamscha. He Krishna Karuna Sindhu, Dina Bandho Jagatpate, Gopesha Gopika Kanta, Radha Kanta Namostate. Taptakanchana Gaurangi, Radhe Vrindavaneshwari, Vrishabhanu Sute Devi, Pranamami Hari Priye. Vancha Kalpatarubhyascha, Kripa Sindhu Devi Vacha, Patitanam Pavanebhyo, Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha. नमावं विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्तस्वामिनिति नाम्नि. नमस्ते सारस्वतीदेवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेषशून्यवादी पाश्चात्यदेशकारिणे. जय श्री कृष्णचैतन्य प्रभुनित्यानन्द श्री अद्वैत गदाधार श्रीवसादि गौरभक्तवृन्द. हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे. हरे कृष्ण. So we are continuing to see from this chapter in Madhya Leela, which is chapter 19, Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu instructs Srila Rupa Goswami. And the verse we read was, when a person receives the seed of devotional service, he should take care of it by becoming a gardener and sowing the seed in his heart. If he waters the seed gradually by the process of shravana and kirtana, hearing and chanting, the seed will begin to sprout. Purport. By His Divine Grace, we see Bhaktivedanta Swami, Srila Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. To live with devotees or to live in a temple means to associate with the Shravana Kirtana process. Sometimes, neophyte devotees think that they can continue the Shravana Kirtana process without worshipping the deity. But the execution of such Shravana Kirtana is meant for highly developed devotees like Haridas Thakur, who engaged in the Shravana Kirtana process without worshipping the deity. However, one should not falsely imitate Haridas Thakur and abandon deity worship just to try to engage in Shravana Kirtana. This is not possible for a neophyte devotee. The word Guru Prasad indicates that the spiritual master is very merciful in bestowing the boon of devotional service upon the disciple. That is the best possible gift the spiritual master has to offer. Those with a background of pious life are eligible to receive life's supreme benefit and to bestow this benefit, the Supreme Personality of Godhead sends his representative to impart his mercy. Endowed with the mercy of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the spiritual master distributes the mercy to those who are elevated and pious. Thus, the spiritual master trains his disciples to render devotional service unto the Supreme Personality of Godhead. This is called Guru Kripa. It is Krishna Prasada, Krishna's mercy, and he sends a bona fide spiritual master to the deserving disciple. By the mercy of Krishna, one meets the bona fide spiritual master, and by the mercy of the spiritual master, the disciple is fully trained in devotional service of the Lord. Bhakti Lata Beej means the seed of devotional service. Everything has an original cause or seed. For any idea, program, plan or device, there is first of all the contemplation of the plan, and that is called as bija or seed. The methods, rules and regulations by which one is perfectly trained in devotional service constitute the Bhakti Lata Beej or seed of devotional service. This Bhakti Lata Beej is received from a spiritual master by the grace of Krishna. Other seeds called Anya Bilasha Beeja include Karma Beeja and Jnana Beeja. If one is not fortunate enough to receive the Bhakti Lata Beej from the spiritual master, he instead cultivates such seeds such as Karma Beeja, Jnana Beeja or political, social or philanthropic Beejas. However, the Bhakti Lata Beej is different from these other Beejas. The Bhakti Lata Beej can be received only through the mercy of a spiritual master. Therefore, one has to satisfy the spiritual master to get the Bhakti Lata Beej, Yasya Prasada, Bhagavat Prasada. The Bhakti Lata Beej is the origin of devotional service. Unless one satisfies the spiritual master, he gets the Beeja or root cause of karma and Jnana Yoga and without the benefit of devotional service. But one who is faithful to his spiritual master gets the Bhakti Lata Beej. This Bhakti Lata Beej is received when one is initiated by a bona fide spiritual master. After receiving the spiritual master's mercy, one must repeat his instructions. This is called Shravana Kirtana, hearing and chanting. One who has not properly heard from the spiritual master or who does not follow the regulative principles is not fit for chanting, Kirtana. This is explained in Bhagavad Gita 241. Vyavasatmikar Buddhi Ekohi Kurunandana. One who has not listened carefully to the instructions of the spiritual master is unfit for chanting or for preaching the cult of devotional service. One has to water the Bhakti Lata Beej by receiving instructions from the spiritual master. Very powerful purport. This purport was by Srila Prabhupada and this verse is 19.152. Very instructive. Very deep, a lot to learn from this. So, we are in this particular chapter where Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu instructed Rupa Goswami at the Dasha Ashwamedha Ghat for 10 days. He began his teachings by describing how rare this human form of life is. He was mentioning in the previous verses how there are 8,400,000 species and 400,000 human-like species are there. And how rare it is to find someone who is actually seeking the highest perfection of Krishna Prema. So in the previous class that we discussed, that was on Thursday by His Grace Adi Gadadhar Prabhu, we read this beautiful verse, Brahmanda Brahmite Kona Bhagyavan Jiva Guru Krishna Prasade Pai Bhakti Lata Beej. So after we have taken this human birth, the greatest fortune for a wandering soul is to come in touch with a bona fide spiritual master who plants this very, very precious seed of devotion. And this seed of devotion is called as Bhakti Lata Beej. And it is planted within the heart of the devotee. And there is nothing that is more sacred than this particular seed that has been planted in our hearts by a spiritual master. So Krishna, we all know he is the Paramatma. He is situated in each and everyone's heart. Krishna gives him a chance to meet a bona fide spiritual master. This is called as Guru Krishna Prasad, both Guru and Krishna's Prasad. Because in the verse, in the previous verse, we saw how Guru Krishna Prasade Pai Bhakti Lata Beej. So it is the mercy of both Guru and Krishna that a person receives this very, very rare seed called as Bhakti Lata Beej. Now Krishna, who is the Paramatma, is prepared to bestow his mercy upon all living entities. And as soon as one living entity desires the Lord's mercy, the Lord immediately gives him an opportunity to meet a bona fide spiritual master. So, such a fortunate person who has the mercy of the spiritual master, who is nourished, who is guided by both Krishna and the spiritual master, he has received the seed in his heart. Now, once he has received the seed in his heart, he is helped from within by Krishna and from outside by the spiritual master. So both are prepared to help a sincere devotee to become free from material bondage. So dormant service to Krishna is already there within everyone's heart. Simply by associating with the devotees, hearing their good instruction, chanting the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, this dormant love for Krishna is awakened, and in this way, one acquires the seed of devotional service, Guru Krishna Prasad Upai, Bhakti Lata Beach. Now, with the mercy of Guru and Krishna, we saw how one has received this seed. Now, what to do with this seed? That is what this verse is all about. We are so fortunate we have received this seed. It is not something that happens very commonly. It's something very, very rare. Now, what to do with this seed? How to nourish it? How to take care of it? That happens by Shravanam Kirtanam. So that is what this verse is saying. And Srila Prabhupada's purport is so elaborate on the fine details. So now that I have the seed and I'm doing Shravanam Kirtanam, is it okay if I do Shravanam Kirtanam all by myself in a secluded place? No. Srila Prabhupada warns, Shravanam Kirtanam in a secluded place without the association of devotees is possible only for exalted souls like Haridas Thakur. He could do it. He could do it non-stop. In fact, Haridas Thakur, he could chant the holy names of Krishna 300,000 times a day without fail. So chanting 300,000 holy names of Krishna is really wonderful. But no ordinary person, but people like us, chanting so many names on a day-to-day basis, it is actually difficult. So we cannot artificially imitate Haridas Thakur's behavior. So we continue to chant a prescribed number of rounds. We continue our services at the temple. We take association of nice devotees. We engage in deity worship also and continue to chant and hear. So Srila Prabhupada has made everything very simple for us. He's given us a very holistic process. He's given us a complete package to keep us properly situated in Krishna consciousness. So Prabhupada says in the third quote, by doing all this, you know, it's a complete package. Perform all this and you will be properly situated in Krishna consciousness. Now we have received Bhakti Lata Beej from a bona fide spiritual master. This is a very rare beej. Prabhupada says on the purport that people receive many kinds of bijas, like jnana bija, karma bija, political bija, social bija, philanthropic bijas, but they are all anya bilasha bijas. This Bhakti Lata bij is very, very rare, given to us by a bona fide spiritual master. So we should begin to take proper care of it. And what is the meaning of watering the seed? Means we are going to chant the holy names of Krishna after hearing and repeating. Listen to proper Krishna Katha. So by repeating the instructions of the spiritual master, after listening to him very carefully, that is actual Shravanam Kirtanam. Listening to the spiritual master, after listening to him very carefully, one repeats the instructions. That is actually Shravanam Kirtanam. So this is the process of watering the seed. But when we are watering the seed, sometimes it so happens that we already have our perception and we fail to see the reality. According to our conditionings, the species of life we are in, the various designations we have identified ourselves with, our desires, our ego, everything we hear is being filtered and everything is going to create a perception. So take a simple analogy. If you wear green glasses, everything will look green. If you wear rose-colored glasses, everything is going to be rosy. So we, the soul, are perceiving life through our ego, then the intelligence, then the mind, and then the five senses. So what is actually reality? It's very easy to get confused. What is actually reality? We are trying to water this seed, but how are we watering it? How are we accessing this hearing, Shravanam? Spiritual life is not about interpreting reality according to our different conceptions and conditions. Real spiritual life is about waking up to the internal underlying substance of truth that is within everything. So if I am an illusion, how do I go from illusion to reality? The situation in this material world is actually very scary. When a blind man leads the blinds, they all go and fall into a ditch. Therefore, the realizations from people who are conditioned are based on ascending system. They themselves trying to figure out things. But adokshaja means revealed knowledge. Evidence that is revealed from God, it is descending down. So we must take the process of the descending principle. So when you buy a complicated piece of machinery, there is an owner's manual that comes from the manufacturer. The owner knows how it actually works and what it is meant for. The manuals of this world are called as Vedas or holy scriptures, and they have been given to us through a bona fide spiritual master and guru parampara. So we must access these bijas according to how the spiritual master has given it to us. And we should, you know, as always Ram Giridhari Prabhu in all his calls, he always says this simple principle, self-guided introspection. That's what he always gives. That is very, very important. It is very important for us to pause and introspect within ourselves to see if we are watering the seed properly. So there may be several bijas, but if one with real sincerity and honesty asks questions about their existence and leaves behind all their preconceived indoctrination, they can easily understand that I am not this body, but I am this consciousness, the life force within this body. This life force is seen through the eyes, tasting through the tongue, and loving through the heart. And then we begin to appreciate the great gift we have received, which is the Bhakti Lata Beej, and we water it very, very carefully. Now, along with that seed, which is so rare, which is so precious, there is also a problem. Many weeds are growing. So any one of you who has done gardening would know how important it is to tend the weeds. We may have a good intention in our life, but due to the conditioning of the mind, so much negativity comes in like weeds. Selfishness, greed, lust, all of these are weeds that can grow along with the seed of bhakti. These are all gross weeds. Now, there are also subtle forms of weeds. What are these subtle forms? They are desire for profit, desire for adoration and distinction. So this is actually, the subtle weeds are actually more difficult to overcome than the gross weeds. So the thoughts we choose to pursue are what will determine whether we water the weed or whether we water the real seed of bhakti or love. Whatever good intentions we have, we are going to be regularly challenged, and the tendency of the mind is to be distracted by these weeds. Once again, we get into the cycle of making wrong choices to give attention to the weeds and the negative thoughts, and we become more and more bound and habituated to them. So if we are not very diligent, the weeds within our hearts can grow stronger, hungrier, and it will become more and more habituated to make choices according to the dictation of these negative, unhealthy thoughts and desires, and gradually everything becomes very corrupted. And we can actually even think that the weed is the seed. We think that the weed is the actual plant that is growing in my heart, and that is what actually makes me happy. So we have to learn to distinguish between the real plant growing from the seed of devotion and the weeds that are inevitably going to be growing around it. The seed of our right intentions needs to be cultivated and watered in three ways. So what are the three ways of watering the seed? First of all, it is satsang, the association with holy people, that gives us the right knowledge, the correct guidance. It protects us from distractions. It gives us proper conception. That is the first step. Then sadhana, our spiritual practices, very, very strong, very, very strong Shravanam Kirtanam, repeating messages of the spiritual master and taking it to our heart. Finally, seva or devotional service. Devotional service is the most practical way of dedicating our thoughts, our words, and our actions to those pure intentions that we are having. All of these together, and also Prabhupada specifically mentions in this purport that devotional service, deity service, all of this is extremely important. We have a lot of energy, spiritual energy. We must dedicate all of that in the service of the Lord. It is important. That's why Prabhupada started these temples where deity worship is encouraged, and devotees are asked to spread the Harinam Sankirtan. So everything, it's a combination of three things: taking proper satsang, doing proper sadhana, as well as doing active devotional service. All of these are important to water this seed, this very rare seed that we have received. So it is described that this material existence is like a huge ocean. It is the ocean of repeated birth and death. And this ocean, this material existence, is so deep and so wide and so long, and practically everyone is simply drowning in this ocean. But this human form of life is considered to be like a boat. It is perfectly suitable boat to cross this ocean. We are so fortunate that we have this boat, we have this human form of life, we have the seed of devotion with us by the mercy of the spiritual master. We are carrying the seed of devotion in this boat. But in order for the boat to cross the ocean, it has to go in the right direction. If we want to go to the kingdom of God, we must keep the boat always directed towards the kingdom of God. So that is very important. The direction is very important. Now, in a boat, we know that what steers the boat? It is the rudder, right, that gives direction to the boat. Now, this rudder is a very small piece of material. The boat is very large, but the entire magnitude of the boat is all directed by this one little piece of wood or steel, which is called as the rudder. So when it go either when the it controls everything that the boat does, you know. If the boat has to go this way, it is controlled by the rudder. If the boat is going that way, it is controlled by the rudder. So the rudder actually controls the direction in which we are watering the seed, the direction in which we are progressing with this Bhakti Lata Beej. So it is described by Srila Jiva Goswami that the tongue is the rudder of the human boat. The tongue controls everything. This human boat, it's a precious species. It's so rare to take a human birth. And it's so even more rare that we have received the seed. But what is controlling everything? What is controlling the direction of how we are proceeding? It is the tongue. So the tongue will determine our direction of life. So if our tongue is glorifying the Lord and glorifying His devotees, then we can understand for sure that the boat of human life is sailing very smoothly. However, we cannot say that human life is always very smooth. There may be some storms in the ocean, but still it is sailing in a constant direction towards the lotus feet of Krishna. But as soon as the tongue is engaged in any other subject matter, you can understand that you are no longer directed towards the kingdom of God. Therefore, in Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says about devotees what they exactly do. Krishna says, Machitta Madgata Prana Bodhayanta Parasparam Katayantascha Mam Nityam Kushan Teacher Anam Teacher. Krishna says, my pure devotees, their lives are surrendered to me and they derive great satisfaction and bliss in enlightening one another and conversing about me. So the process of hearing and chanting is the very basis of our spiritual life. Therefore, we must know how important it is to keep the topics of Krishna in our mind, because the sound vibration determine the condition of our mind. Of course, we have all experienced this, either before coming to Krishna consciousness or after coming to Krishna consciousness. Definitely, we have all experienced this. When the atmosphere is filled with sound vibrations in the mode of ignorance and passion, the consciousness of the people will be very intensely infected by these modes of ignorance and passion. When the atmosphere is filled with sound vibration of mode of goodness, then everyone's consciousness will naturally be affected positively and uplifted. You know, even among general masses, when they are all listening to all these rock music and jazz, everyone is constantly agitated. The same group of people, when they are in a temple or in a spiritual place, they feel very calm because they are associating with the mode of goodness. So the sound vibrations makes a huge difference in our lives. So when transcendental sound is filled in the atmosphere, then the purification of the consciousness of everyone takes place. That is the reason why we must always associate the transcendental sound vibration. And that is why we chant the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. Because the sound of this mantra, it is not material. It is coming directly from the spiritual world. It is divine. And it easily penetrates into the thick layer of our material consciousness. We have a very thick layer of material consciousness covering all of us. So this Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, it has the capacity to penetrate through the consciousness. The sound, and this sound that we hear of the Maha Mantra becomes even more potent when some advanced devotee or serious practitioner of Krishna consciousness chants the mantra. So the rationale behind this concept is that the holy names of Krishna are not material. They are descending from the spiritual realm. So a pure devotee of the Lord vibrates the holy name. When they do that, they actually access the spiritual world, and the pure name vibrates in their tongues. They practically import the holy name due to their own unlimited purity of the heart. So in this association of such souls, we also get purified as we are able to access the holy name. So that's why sometimes it is suggested that first of all, we must chant an association. That really helps a lot to improve our japa. And second thing is, oftentimes it is suggested that we chant with Srila Prabhupada's tape, because he has access. So he is importing the holy name directly from the spiritual world. So it will help all of us to access it. So our association of a person infected with tuberculosis, it will expose us to the risk of getting the same disease because of the air that is transmitting all the germs. Likewise, when we associate with a person infected with love of God and we hear from him and we repeat his words and we chant with him, then the germs of this rich spiritual emotions of that person and of Krishna, that will enter our heart, and it will even enter the heart of a person who is an unwilling listener. If the words of the person who is repeating the statements of Guru is infected with rich spiritual emotions, even an unwilling listener who is not ready to listen to Harikatha, even he will be infected. Slowly all these germs of spiritual sound will do their job, and the person will be completely infected with spiritual consciousness. So this is exactly how the process of watering the seed, Shravanam Kirtanam, works. So we get the seed, we nourish the seed, how we water the seed, all this is very important. What are the upadis that happen during watering the seed? That also we have to be very careful. Where does the problem come from? We should figure that out. And how to solve it? We have to figure it out. And how do we enhance the watering of the seed? It is enhanced by taking the vibrations from such spiritually exalted people and doing the sadhana with them, hearing their lectures, hearing the lectures of Guru Parampara, chanting with them. So all this help nourish the seed really, really fast. Now let's take an example. Now we have seen about the seed. We have to nourish it very carefully. We have to tend to the leaves. We have seen all of this. Now let's take an example of how this process of receiving the seed from a spiritual master and cultivating the seed carefully will actually reap benefits. So the example is there in the Srimad Bhagavatam. And the example is the classic story of Dhruva Maharaj from Srimad Bhagavatam. So we all know the story of Dhruva Maharaj. Once upon a time, there was a great king called King Uttanapad. He had two queens, and the names of the queens were Suniti and Suruchi. Now Suruchi, she was very dear to the king, and Suniti, who also had a son by the name Dhruva, was not really his favorite. So once, while this King Uttanapada was patting the son of Suruchi called Uttama and placing him on the lap, the son of Suniti, known as Dhruva Maharaj, was also trying to get onto his father's lap. But because the king was kind of very, very attached to Suruchi, he was a little not very comfortable with Dhruva Maharaj coming to his lap. He was trying to be a little hesitant. He was not welcoming him properly. Actually speaking, this King Uttanapada, he was very affectionate to both his sons. He was affectionate to both Uttama and Dhruva. But since he had a natural inclination, a favoritism towards his queen Suruchi, he could not welcome Dhruva Maharaj very openly. He couldn't show his feelings very openly. So King Uttanapada's feeling was understood by Suruchi. You know, she was trying to manipulate. She could understand, okay, so the king is hesitating. That means he has favoritism towards me. So I can speak boldly, she thought. So with great pride, she began to speak to the king. In presence of the king, she began to scold Dhruva Maharaj, who was trying to get onto the lap of his father. So she told Dhruva Maharaj, my little child, you do not deserve to sit on the throne of the lap of the king. You cannot sit on the throne, neither can you sit on the lap of the king. Because though you may be the son of the king, because you did not take birth from my womb, you are not qualified to sit on your father's lap. So Suruchi was very proudly telling this to Dhruva Maharaj, that to be the king's son was not the only qualification for sitting on the lap or throne of the king, but rather the privilege was dependent on one having taken birth from her womb. Unless Dhruva had taken birth from her womb, he didn't have the qualification to sit on the throne or to sit on his father's lap. So she told Dhruva, if at all you have the desire to rise to the throne of the king, you must undergo several austerities. First of all, you must satisfy the Supreme Personality of God and Narayana. Then, when you are favored by him because of such worship, you have to take your next birth from my womb. So Suruchi was very envious of Dhruva Maharaj, that she told him that he had to change his body. According to her, first of all, Dhruva had to die, then take his next birth in her womb, and only then it will be possible for Dhruva to ascend the throne of his father. So Dhruva Maharaj, he felt very bad. He was struck by the strong words of his stepmother. He became very angry. When he saw that his father was silent and not protesting to what Mother Suruchi had said, he immediately left that place and he went running to his mother. He went and told his mother Suniti everything that had happened. And when Suniti heard this, she also felt very aggrieved. She was also very angry and upset, but she did not know a factual remedy for the situation. So she didn't find any other solution. And then she called to her son and she told her son, my dear son, actually, we should never wish anything inauspicious for others. Anyone who inflicts pain upon others actually suffers himself. He suffers that pain too. It is true, my child, that I am not the favorite wife of your mother. And hence, you being my son is actually very unfortunate. Without further delay, you must actually listen to the words of your stepmother. You go and engage yourself in the worship of the lotus feet of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And that is what will actually give you the solution. So, the harsh words of Suruchi, the stepmother, to her stepson were actually very true. Because unless one is favored by the Supreme Lord, one cannot achieve any success in life. Man proposes, God disposes. So Suniti, who is the mother of Dhruva Maharaj, agreed with her co-wife's advice that Dhruva should engage himself in the worship of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So indirectly, the words of Suruchi were actually a benediction for Dhruva Maharaj. Because of the influence of his stepmother's words, Dhruva became a great devotee. So Suniti told her, my dear boy, now you should take shelter of the Supreme Lord. And he is very, very kind to his devotees. And even persons seeking liberation from this cycle of birth and death, they always take shelter of the Supreme Lord, of the Supreme Personality of Godhead in devotional service. So you came to me crying. You have been insulted by your stepmother. And I am unable to do any good for you. But Krishna is so kind to his devotees. If you go to him, then the combined kindness of millions of mothers like me will be surpassed by his affectionate, tender dealings. Krishna is so nice. He is equivalent or he surpasses even hundreds and thousands of mothers. His affection is beyond limits. So when everyone else fails to mitigate your mercy, Krishna will be able to help you. So as soon as one places the Supreme Personality of Godhead within his heart, everything becomes very, very easy and very, very successful. So like this, she advised her little son, and Dhruva Maharaj, who was a very small boy, after deliberate consideration and with the intelligence and fixed determination, he left his father's house. He went to the forest to perform austerities to somehow or the other see the Supreme Personality of Godhead face to face. So, while Dhruva Maharaj was in the forest, the great sage Narada, he overheard this news, and understanding all the activities of Dhruva Maharaj, he was struck with wonder. So, one may ask now, how did Narada know of this, right? So, we have already seen in this verse, in this particular verse that we were discussing today, we're trying to apply this verse to the story, to this incident of Dhruva Maharaj. So, how did Narada know of this? In this verse, it is explained that the Supreme Personality of Godhead is present in everyone's heart, and as soon as he understands that the living entity is serious about entering devotional service, he sends his representative. So the Supreme Personality of Godhead sent Narada Muni. So in this way, Narada came to know of the matter, and he was sent to Dhruva Maharaj. As it is explained in this verse, Guru Krishna Prasadipai Lakti Bhakti Lata Beej. So by the grace of the spiritual master and Krishna, one can enter into devotional service. Now, Dhruva Maharaj found his spiritual master, and he also had the grace of Krishna. Now, because of Dhruva Maharaj's determination, Krishna, who is the super soul, immediately sent his representative Narada to get him initiated. Now, the great sage Narada, he appeared in front of Dhruva and told him, "My dear boy, you are only a little boy who must be playing and doing small childlike activities at this age. Why are you so affected by the words of your stepmother? How come insult and honor has become so important to you? You're just a little kid. Because if you go and insult a little kid or go and glorify him, he will think about it for a minute, but he will not take it so seriously that he's going to go and perform austerity. Why are you ready to take so much austerities under the instruction of your stepmother? So, in my opinion, such austerities are not possible for any human being. And first of all, you are such a small child. Why do you want to do all this?" So he went and asked Dhruva. So Narada Muni, he is the supreme spiritual master, and he came and he was trying to test Dhruva Maharaj to just see how determined he is. So Narada came to Dhruva under the direction of the Supreme Lord just to initiate him, yet he was testing the determination that Dhruva had to execute the process. So it is a fact that even for a sincere person, devotional service, steady devotional service is possible. It is possible. It is possible. But it is possible only when we have the sincere determination. But for one who is not determined and not sincere, this process is extremely difficult. Anyway, Dhruva was very determined and he didn't listen to the words of Narada Muni, and he asked him, "Oh great sage, aren't you Narada Muni? You know the Supreme Lord very well. So first tell me, how can I see Narayana? That is my focus. I'm very determined. I want to see Lord Narayana. You just tell me the process." So Narada Muni, when he heard this and he saw the determination of Dhruva Maharaj, he felt very, very happy. And being a very true spiritual master who's naturally kind and eager to see each and every single soul go back to Godhead, he mercifully agreed to accept Dhruva as his disciple and instruct him on how to find God. So Dhruva told Narada Muni, "I want a kingdom that is not only greater than my father's, but greater than even Lord Brahma, the controller of this universe." So this was the initial desire that Dhruva Maharaj had when he began his austerities. Now, looking at his necessity, looking at the desire of Dhruva Maharaj, by transcendental standards of Narada, this boy should not have taken family insults so seriously. But Narada Muni, he reasoned within himself, "It is okay, he's only a small boy. He's very determined to approach the Supreme Lord. Forget the reason, let me not think about the reason, but let me help him because he's so determined." So Narada told Dhruva how to absorb himself in devotional service. He gave him the seed of devotional service to Dhruva Maharaj. This Bhakti Lata Beej was planted in the heart of Dhruva Maharaj. Guru Krishna Prasadipai Bhakti Lata Beej. Guru came, Krishna came. Okay? Then the seed was planted in the heart of Dhruva. Okay? This all-powerful seed of devotional service was planted in the heart of Dhruva Maharaj. Now, Narada Muni, he gave him all guidance. He told him about the form of the Lord, how to meditate on the form of the Lord. He gave him a mantra that he must chant. He explained to him how he must make a deity of the Lord with sand on the banks of river Yamuna in Madhuvan, and how to worship this deity. He was asked to meditate on the pastimes of the Lord. All these instructions were given. You can read from the Srimad Bhagavatam. What are the instructions that were given by Narada Muni? Narada Muni guided him in every single step. He told him the process. He told him how to take care of the seed. He told him how to water the seed, how to execute this process of devotional service. So after he received these instructions, after he received the seed, Dhruva Maharaj, he began to water the seed of devotion as given by Narada Muni with the mantra, chanting very attentively without offenses. So when one acts very seriously on the order of the spiritual master, then there is no anxiety about reaching perfection. So Dhruva Maharaj, he undertook severe penances in order to realize God. And slowly, this creeper of devotion began to blossom in his heart. The creeper became a big plant. And while he was practicing, the purification was also happening. Everything was happening. He was very sincere. He didn't cultivate the weeds. He was very, very single focused in his mind. And he sincerely practiced. The creeper became a tree. It pierced the spiritual world as it became a huge, huge tree. So we must understand that in comparison with Dhruva Maharaj, they're all very insignificant in terms of practicing spiritual life. We cannot do anything difficult like saintly Dhruva in order to reach the perfection. But by the mercy of Lord Chaitanya in this present age, everything has become so simple. Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has given us such a simple process. It has been given to us in such a simple manner by Srila Prabhupada and all the Guru Vargas. So we have to accept this seed and cultivate this seed. So Dhruva, he engaged in his meditation, and the form of the Lord in his heart, in which he was fully absorbed in, all of a sudden disappeared, just like an electric lightning. And then when he was perturbed because he couldn't see the form of the Lord in his meditation, Dhruva opened his eyes and he saw before him the all-beautiful Supreme Personality of Godhead, the form that he was meditating on. The vision in his heart had disappeared, and he thought for a minute he had lost the Lord. But now Lord Narayana was standing before him, and Dhruva fell flat before the Lord. Dhruva Maharaj was in so much ecstasy. He looked upon the Lord as if he was drinking the Lord with his eyes, kissing the lotus feet of the Lord with his mouth, and embracing the Lord with his arms. Dhruva started off with a materially motivated desire. Remember? He was materially motivated, but Narada Muni decided to give him the seed anyways because he was determined. Dhruva Maharaj started off with a materially motivated desire, but still he received the right seed. He received the right seed of bhakti. He received the right seed of guru, from the right spiritual master. He watered the seed very, very carefully without nourishing the weed, and he was completely successful in his attempt. So although Dhruva Maharaj was a very small boy, he wanted to offer prayers to the Supreme Lord in a suitable language, but because he was so inexperienced, he couldn't even speak up anything. Then we know the story, how the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who is situated in each and every one of our hearts, could understand Dhruva Maharaj's awkward position, and out of his causeless mercy, he touched the conch shell to the forehead of Dhruva, who stood before him in folded hands. And when Dhruva Maharaj felt hesitant, not knowing how to describe the Lord because of inexperience, out of the Lord's causeless mercy, the Lord again touched him. Yes, again the Lord is giving mercy. Not only did the Lord give him mercy in sending a spiritual master and he receiving the beej, the Bhakti Lata beej, and the beej became a creeper and it grew and it became a tree and it pierced the Viraja Nadi and it went to the spiritual world and the Lord came in front of him. Not only that, when the Supreme Lord saw the condition of Dhruva, that he was not able to speak up, he was so merciful, he took the conch and placed it on his forehead so that he could be transcendently inspired. So this transcendental inspiration is called as Brahmamaya, Srila Prabhupada writes in the purport. Because when one is touched, this is a very nice sentence. I really wanted to repeat it directly from the purport. So I'm going to repeat this. It's very beautiful. This transcendental inspiration is called as Brahmamaya. Because when one is thus inspired, the sound he produces exactly corresponds to the sound vibration of the Vedas. This is not the ordinary sound vibration of the material world. Therefore, the sound vibration of the Hare Krishna Mahamantra, although presented in the ordinary alphabet, should not be taken as mundane or material. It is very important to note that actually to glorify the Lord properly, one needs the mercy of Guru and Krishna, else it is not possible. The Supreme Lord knew very well what was there in Dhruva's heart, and he offered him the entire planet called as Dhruvaloka. So despite having achieved the desired result of his determination by worshipping the lotus feet of the Lord, Romaraj, after he was awarded the Dhruvaloka, he was blessed by the Lord, he offered prayers, everything was over, the Lord also went back. Dhruva Maharaj was not at all happy at the end of all this. He felt so ashamed. Why did he feel so ashamed? Because he felt he demanded something from the Lord. He shouldn't have done this. He demanded something very material. Devotees don't like to ask the Lord for anything material, even if it is mukti. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has told us in several places, no, I don't want anything. I don't even want liberation. All that the devotees want is to serve the Lord wherever they are. So this realization Dhruva Maharaj had when he saw the Supreme Lord present in front of him personally, and how did this realization come up is also explained. Because when he directly saw the Lord face to face, he was elevated to the Vasudeva platform. Vasudeva platform refers to pure goodness, or in other words, there is no question of any modes of material nature. Like we have sattva, rajas, tamas, right? So there are three modes of material nature. Dhruva Maharaj transcended these three modes and he went to the mode of pure goodness. The other word for the name of pure goodness is called as the Vasudeva platform. It is because on the Vasudeva platform, one can see God face to face, the Lord is also called as Vasudeva. So another reason why the Lord is called as Vasudeva. So when he saw the Lord face to face, he completely understood how unimportant his demand was and his material conditions were, and he became so upset and he exclaimed, Dhana bilashi tapasaistitoham tvam praptavan deva munindra guhyam kacham vichinvam api divya ratnam swamin kritartosmi varam nayachi. When he was being blessed by the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Dhruva Maharaj said, O my Lord, because I was seeking an opulent material position, I was performing severe types of penance and austerity. Now I have gotten you, who are very difficult for the demigods and saintly persons and kings to attain. I was searching after pieces of glass, but instead I have found you, who is the most valuable jewel. Therefore, I am so satisfied that I do not wish to ask any other benediction from you. And this verse is from the Hari Bhakti Sudodaya and also Chaitanya Charitamrita Madhyalila 22:42. So Dhruva Maharaj, he had this realization, what was I doing? I was looking for broken pieces of glass. And I have such a great jewel in front of me and I was looking for something material. So this is the story of Dhruva Maharaj. It just gives us an idea of how he received the seed from the spiritual master, how the process of watering the seed was, and how he finally saw the Supreme Lord and even had the realization that he shouldn't be asking for anything else other than the Supreme Lord. He was completely elevated from the platform of even the mode of goodness. So this is a very inspiring story. We are all very extremely fortunate that we have the seed of bhakti given to us by our spiritual master and Srila Prabhupada. We must be very careful to hear the message and water the seed by hearing and chanting in the association of devotees. We should continue our services to the deities in a humble state of mind. And then this bija can result in a bhakti lata, a creeper of devotion. It can become a big plant. It can become a big tree. It will grow and grow and grow beyond this material world. Pierce into the viraja, reach the spiritual world, and then we can taste the fruits of this creeper. So I'd like to stop here. If anyone has any comments, corrections, realizations, please share. This class was from transcriptions of Guru Maharaj and purpose of Srila Prabhupada from Chaitanya Charitamrita and Srimad Bhagavatam. So if anyone has anything to comment, please go ahead. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna Mataji, Dandavat Pranam. Very, very, very beautiful class, very nice realizations, and the way you connected Dhruva Maharaj about the purity of and how we have to be careful about thoughts, the desires, watering the weeds, and we would not be watering Bhakti Lata as such, and then you were also telling about the green glasses, and if we wear that, everything will be green. And our thoughts coming with our desires through the ego, the mind and the senses, and you gave that analogy how we could perceive things in a wrong manner. Really very beautiful eye-opening class, Mataji. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mataji. All glories to Guru Maharaj and Prabhupada. It was just a compilation of many transcriptions. Thank you, Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Thank you so much, Mataji, for such a wonderful lecture. And when I was thinking, like, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu used to hear this katha about Dhruv Maharaj daily. So it's very important to hear about the devotees so that we can learn from those characters how to live life. So thank you so much, Mataji, for the pastime of Dhruv Maharaj and for the instructions you gave from that. Thank you so much, Hare Krishna.
Thank you so much, Pavitra Madhavi Mataji. Thank you so much for always being there. Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. I'll go show Prabhupada Guru Maharaj. I'm sorry, I kept cutting out in between, so I don't know if I missed it or if you mentioned it. But so how does one recognize these weeds? Especially those subtle weeds are very hard to distinguish. Sometimes you think you're doing it for a good reason. There's a, you know, it's for Prabhupada or whatever. But it may not be. So how does one distinguish a true weed?
Yeah, as I said, you know, if we wear a green glass, I mean, we have a lot of preconceived notions. We have these indoctrinations, and we try to apply it when we are hearing. So Guru Maharaj always says that when we hear something, it is filtered through our consciousness. We want to listen to it the way we want to perceive things. That is very true. It happens with each one of us. It has happened with me many times. So that is something that is very true. So that's where we have to pause and try to hear the message as it is real. You know, that comes with self-guided introspection, as Ramgiri Vani Prabhu always mentions in his classes. I think that is so important for each one of us. We have to take a neutral stand. Think about ourselves. Am I doing it right? Am I taking it correct? Take advice from people who are associated with us, who have been seeing us do it several times in the past, and take their opinion with a neutral mind. Then that will clear out a lot of doubts that we have. Because we are all bound to perceive things the way we want to hear it, the way we want to perceive it, the way we want to project ourselves. It is not about we all the time. That's what happens. But we have to take a neutral stand and see, is this correct or is this wrong? You know, am I trying to justify what I'm doing, or is it what Guru Sadhu Shastra want? That's why our standard is always given for Guru, Sadhu, Shastra. We have to check all the three. Guru, what does Guru say? What is Sadhu saying? What are the other devotees saying? What are other Vaishnavas talking about this? And Shastra, is Shastra agreeing to what I'm thinking? So when we match the three, certainly there will be some clarity. But this preconceived notions and trying to see things the way we want to see it, that is going to be there. But when the matter, when you feel that, you know, there is some problem here, we should stop and think. So it's a combination of many things, Mataji. It takes time for introspection and some time with the devotees. That could probably help. Did that answer?
Yes, Mataji, thank you.
Yes. Thank you so much, Mataji, for the Yashis Maharaj. Thank you so much, Mataji. Ananga Gopika Mataji. Thank you so much. Anjana Gopika, who joined? Thank you, Mataji.
Thank you, Mataji. Very nice to have explained. Connected with the Guru Maharaj's story and how he attained perfection. Hare Krishna. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mataji. Thank you so much.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Mataji.
Hare Krishna Mataji.
Yeah, this class made me realize that you aren't good only at telling Ramayana stories. I think you were just gifted for telling stories in general, because this one was so nicely told also. And one thing that I really appreciated too was I never heard the psychology behind King Uttanipad's reasoning for treating Dhruva in that way, you know, that he didn't want to, let's say, offend Queen Suruchi. And even though he really did have affection for Dhruva, but it was because he was conscious of Suruchi's presence, I guess, and I never heard that perspective before, you know.
Yeah, that's there in the purport of Srila Prabhupada. I can send a verse, because I just took it from the purport, about this, why Usinga Uttanapada was having this hesitation. So Prabhupada explains very sweetly in that purport.
But anyway, you should go on telling all stories, Mataji, because that's your gift.
Thank you so much, Mataji, for your encouragement and always giving support to all the devotees on the call. Thank you, Mataji.
Yeah, I'm just saying, don't restrict your storytelling to Ramayana, because this was so expertly told also. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mataji.
Thank you so much. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Thank you so much.
And this call, it's also recorded, right? It will be made available?
Yes, Mataji. Yes, we will send the recording. Yes, sure.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Dhanat Pranam.
Hare Krishna, Mataji.
Thank you so much, Mataji. The very beautiful class. And the way you explained, Mataji, you gave the example of Dhruva Maharaj, how he got the seed of Bhakti Lata, and then how he was in the sadhana bhakti, and how he was practicing very seriously, and he saw face to face, he got the mercy of Krishna, and face to face he saw Lord Vishnu. It was very nice, Mataji. And also I was thinking, we are so fortunate to get that seed from our spiritual master, but same time we are not utilizing the seed, you know, means how we should be very careful, because one sense we are very fortunate, but other sense we are taking care, means taking this seed very deeply.
Very true, Mataji. Very, very true. It's such a precious gift, you know, actually as Dhruva Maharaj in the end, he says, I got such something really great, but I didn't use it properly, right? He said, I was able to see the Lord face to face, but I asked for broken pieces of glass. And actually, this quote is directly not from the Bhagavatam. It comes in Hari Bhakti Sudodaya. But the verse he says in Bhagavatam is also very similar. He also says one more verse in Bhagavatam where he says, a person had the favor of a great emperor, and when the emperor was ready to give him everything, this beggar, he asked him for some broken pieces of grains, some discardable grains. He could have asked the king for anything, but he asked only for some, you know, broken pieces of grains. So how stupid sometimes we are, you know, when we have a very precious thing with us, we take it very cheaply. Yeah, I thought what you said is very true, Mataji. Very, very true.
Thank you, Mataji. It was very wonderful class. Thank you for your association, all the devotees. Thank you.
Thank you, Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Priti Vilasini, Mataji. Are you going to continue sometime the Ramayana, or we just...
We'll continue, Mataji. It depends on the devotees' need. If the devotees like, we can finish it off. I just wanted the opinion of devotees. So if we are anyhow halfway through Sundarakanda, so we'll finish off Yudhakanda and it'll be over in 2-3 classes, hopefully. But thank you, Mataji. We'll surely finish the series, because we started it and it's not nice if we don't finish.
Yeah, it's very nice. Thank you.
Thank you, Mataji.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Actually, today I was coming for... Yeah, actually, today I was coming for... Yes.
Somebody is speaking. Matasam Mataji.
Maneshwari Mataji, you wanted to say something?
Yeah, I'm sorry, I keep interrupting you. You said hopefully we'll be finished in 3 or 4 classes. No, hopefully we won't, you mean?
Oh, yeah, mostly we won't. Because each of these will take a lot of time if we want to do it in detail, yeah. Yeah. Yes. So actually today, since we didn't have Savitri Mataji, since she's traveling, she's out of town this week, so I just thought I'll cover for her and do Chaitanya Charitamrita. That's all, Mataji.
And Hare Krishna, Prithvilas Mataji, she's also giving on everyday chant called the Brahma Samhita classes. So sometime maybe you can arrange for her to
Saturday. That's right, Mataji. Shama Gauri Mataji has called her for Saturday classes on Brahma Samhita to finish that series also. And Mataji said she will be there. But since she's traveling this week alone, she won't be able to finish this week. But from next week, she'll be back to schedule where she will do both weekend classes as well as Chaitanya Charitamrita class.
Oh, okay. And Parikshit Maharaj, he was into Rahu Gansu, you know, okay. I mean, Janaparas, he did the Rishabdev's teaching, and then now he's doing the Bharat Maharaj, Janaparas, he's giving instructions to King Rahungan. It's very nice.
Yes, Mataji. So Shama Gauri Mataji said even that will continue during the weekends as usual. Both.
That will be nice. Thank you, Hare Krishna. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Mataji.
Yes, Mataji.
Just one last thing. I was just wondering if all of Marisa Bitri's Brahma Samhita classes have been recorded.
Yeah, I have to see because I know one Prabhu was working on the folders, saving all the classes and putting it into a folder so that they can send it to ISKCON Desiratory. I can check with him to see if everything is converted to MP3. The problem is there were some talks that were just recorded and not converted to MP3. So the links are not available after a point in time, you know. They die after a point in time. So I have to check with that Prabhu and then see what can be done about this. So he was the one who was converting things into MP3. So I'll check with him and let you know.
Yeah, in other words, don't go, too much out of your way or a lot of trouble. You know, it was only if it was if it were readily available, then, but not to take up your time,
We'll figure it out. Yes, Mataji, sure, definitely. Yeah.
Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you, Mataji. Thank you all so much again. So if no one else has any questions or realizations or comments, we can end the class. Vancha kalpakarubhyascha kripa sindhubhyo vacha patitanam pavanebhyo vaishnavebhyo namo
namo.
अनंत कोटि वैष्णव वृंद की जय श्रील प्रभुपाद की जय
गौर प्रेम
गौर प्रेमानंदे हरे कृष्ण और ग्लोरी टू द असेंबल्ड डिवोटीज
की
जय अनंत कोटि वैष्णव वृंद की जय हरे कृष्ण